So the overall goal of industrial biotechnology is to develop new bio-based technologies for converting renewable raw materials, and I'll tell you a bit about those, into products such as chemicals, biofuels, bioplastics. So there's sort of three elements applied to industrial biotechnology. There's the starting material, which is going to be ideally biomass, something that's renewable. There's going to be the process of conversion, some sort of bioprocess, and then there are going to be the products, and then we're going to finish off towards the end of the lecture looking at the type of products that you can make using this sort of biotechnology-based approach. Now the real, I'm going to spend quite a bit of time on this at the beginning, the real sort of importance of this field is that potentially this is a way of replacing products, chemicals, fuels that are currently made from the petroleum-based industry. Okay, and you've probably read a lot about this in the newspaper, if you read New Scientist, we're at this position now for reasons I'll go into, where we need to find some longer-term solutions for manufacture of the sort of things that you take for granted, chemicals, fuels, etc. We need to find other ways of making them because of the issues around the sort of supplies of oil and gas. So, and we're going to look at how this happens. What we need to do is develop enzymes or microorganisms, which are going to be the sort of catalysts converting the biomass to these bioproducts, so we can look at how you develop these biocatalysts and how you engineer them so that they're sort of fit for purpose in terms of industrial applications. So we know we live in an oil economy. Basically, the last 200 or 300 years, we've essentially developed a way globally of using oil to make all of the sort of products that we use on a day-to-day basis and all the fuels that we use for transportation. And oil is fractionated, and it's a fantastic, I mean, oil is, if you think about it, it's actually a bio resource. It's all the oil that's developed or derived from plants, but it's a non-renewable resource. That's the problem with oil, is we just use it up. We can't, it takes so long to convert plants into crude oil that we can't possibly renew it in our lifetime. But it's a fantastic resource because you can fractionate it, you can use it to make all that sort of that are used on a sort of day-to-day basis. This is one of those interesting maps where you organize the world according to the size of the country represents who has the oil. Okay, so you can see, if you look at Europe, which is quite a big sort of continent, it's tiny represented in this way, because it basically is not a good source of crude oil. Most of the crude oil in the world, about 25% percent of it's found in the Middle East. A lot of it's in Russia. The colour indicates who uses the oil. So most of the oil is used, so the darker the colour, the greens and the dark blues indicate who actually uses the oil. So Europe uses a huge amount of crude oil, but actually produces very, very little. And what's going to happen to this map? This is what we call the global oil economy. In terms of where biofuels are going to come from, the whole thing is probably going to shift from the Middle East to South America. South America is likely to be country because they have large amounts of land mass that they can use not just for food but for biofuel production. This sort of map is going to shift, so you know, in 10 or 20 years time the Middle East will become a smaller portion of South America will become larger because that's where the biofuel economy will essentially grow. So some interesting statistics. The chemical industry, which is what I'm going to address today, uses only about 7% oil consumption. Okay, so actually the chemical industry is not the problem. The problem is energy, is heating and transportation, which uses about 90% of all the crude oil that's dug out of the ground on a daily basis. So if you used all of the oil in the tar sand deposits, they were exclusively available for production of chemicals, there would be no problem. It's a glut of raw material. But the problem is the supplies of oil will not last forever. We need to find alternative ways of deriving some of these products. So you've probably seen this sort of slide before. This is the sort of prediction. This keeps changing. This is the prediction of when the oil reserves are likely to run out. Okay. And to some extent, this curve gets pushed further and further into the future, partly because people find new sources of crude oil, probably around fracking, which is shale gas. So fracking is a relatively new technology which enables you to essentially unlock gas that was previously sort of buried in the Earth's crust. But when, you know, however far you push this into the future, this will at some point crude oil will start to run out. I think there was an article in the Times earlier this week that said 2100 has to be the, which is, sounds like a long time away. 2100 has to be the time when we really sort of stop depending on crude oil as a resource. So, you know, what will the supply chain of tomorrow look like? Will it be bio-based? Almost certainly it will be much more bio-based. Another big issue is this competition between food and fuel. So Europe cannot afford to devote its land for fuel production. You have to feed the people first. Okay, so there's always a tension, quite an important tension. There's a sort of political element to this between what do you use the land for. And in Europe, you have to use it to produce food. The population is growing. That's another big issue. I'm not really going to touch on that. But the population is growing almost out of control. So if you are going to produce crops, it's got to be somewhere where there's not so much demand on land for food. So people are now starting to talk about this sort of mixed oil bioeconomy. So you'll see the figures in a minute. More and more products are being derived from bio feedstocks. So we're in this sort of transitional phase at the moment. So I gave this lecture to the undergraduates in Manchester, and one of the students last year said, it's all about money. You can talk about sustainability, and that's a very nice thing to do, but ultimately this is a huge commercial opportunity for companies who want to develop bio-based chemicals and bio-based fuels. And you can see, if you look at that curve, the rate of growth is tremendous. This is the prediction. So in 2014, which is where we are at the moment, the value of the green chemical markets, so chemicals, fuels that are made from bio-based approaches, is about $10 billion per annum. By 2020, it's predicted to grow tenfold to $100 billion. Okay, so if you're a company in this area, there are big opportunities commercially to make money from this. Interestingly, the world chemical market is about $2.5 trillion. Okay, so even in 2020, if the value of green chemicals which is about $100 billion. It's sort of a fraction of the total world chemical market, which is about $2.5 trillion. Now, sustainability. So here's the definition of sustainability. And the bit that I've highlighted in red, I think, is the key thing. It's about not just living now in a sustainable fashion, but really preserving what we have now for future generations. That's the key issue of sustainability. You don't use everything up now. You actually hand over to the next generation something that's in good shape. So what I was going to do here is just think a little bit about waste. Okay, so if you can minimize waste, that would obviously help reduce the sort of demand on resources. You'll hear a lot of people talk about scarcity of water as being a major issue. Okay, I'll show you some data on that. And also some issues around diminishing resources as well. So here's some, again, scary statistics. 93% of production materials do not end up in saleable products. So when you make any chemical, you make a huge amount of waste that doesn't end up in the product. Okay, interestingly, the most efficient part of the chemical industry is the oil industry. The oil industry converts about 99% of its resource into products that it sells. The least efficient chemical industry is the pharmaceutical industry. It produces about 100 times the amount of waste for every kilogram of pharmaceutical that it produces. It's a waste. 80% of products are discarded after a single use. We all know, we live in this sort of society now where we tend to buy things, use them, and chuck them away. Okay? We've sort of become consumer sort of driven and obsessed. And this is the worst one. 99% of materials used in the production of or contained within goods are discarded in the first 6 weeks. Okay, so is that sustainable? Probably not. That sort of lifestyle. Drinkable water. Okay, so this is a map of the world that's coloured according to access to improved drinking water. So clearly, if you live in Africa, a major issue is that you don't have access to high quality water. If you start using more and more land for producing crops for biofuels, you will use up water at a rate that may impact availability of drinking water. So that's another, you've got to get these balances right. You know, it's all very well to go down one route, but if it starts to impact on sort of food security and health, then it's obviously a sensible thing to sort of do. Here's another what I call scary diagram. So this is the periodic table. So you sort of look at the periodic table and you think, you know, all of those elements will be around forever. This is highlighting which elements are under threat. Okay, so all elements are found in the Earth's crust or the Earth's atmosphere. So again, there's a finite supply of natural elements. Red are the worst, so precious metals. Indium, which is used in display technologies, is running out. Some of these things are going to run out in 20, 30, 40 years' time. I'm not trying to scare you, I'm just trying to point out that everything is finite in this sense. Phosphorus, this is the worst one. So, you would have thought that if you think about phosphates in the Earth's crust, you would have thought there would be an infinite supply of phosphorus in the Earth. It's so heavily used for fertilizers that it's effectively, we're using it faster than we can produce it. It's running out. Okay? If we didn't have fertilizers, then again, production of crops would be a huge problem. Lithium for batteries. So this is changing as well. Okay, so let's look at industrial biotechnology. Now, on the one hand, this is a new technology, and on the other hand, there are some established products and processes that are already out there. So I thought maybe you know some of these. I thought I'd run through some of these. So insulin, in the 1950s, if you had diabetes, you took insulin from that guy there, from the pig. It was isolated naturally from pigs. And in fact, not only is that, again, not sustainable, particularly if you're a pig, but some people had problems taking pig insulin. It's not actually an identical to humans, and there's some subtle differences. Anyway, mainly to address the issue of making it much more widely available, the gene that encodes for insulin, and I'll talk a little bit about genetics, was cloned, overexpressed, and is now produced in bacterium, so you've got essentially a recombinant industrial source of insulin. So all insulin now is made by this process. Washing powders, so the issues here are people want to clean their clothes at lower and lower temperatures, so rather than use heat to sort of remove fats, lipids, stains, etc. All washing powders, all biological washing powders now contain enzymes, proteases, amylases, lipases. They help to break down the fats, the proteins, the stains, and basically run these processes now at much lower temperature. But again, these enzymes have all been engineered. So the only way that they become suitable for sort of practical industrial application, which is what we're going to move on to in a minute, is we need to take the enzymes from nature and engineer them to make them more robust, more active, more specific. And then another classic example, stonewashed genes. So you can get that faded denim effect in two ways. You can take denims, which contain indigo, which gives the colour, and if you mechanically wear them down, you get that. Historically, that was done using pumice stone, so you would have these big industrial dishwashers, pumice stone, which is very hard, in with denim jeans, and if you just mechanically wear them down, you get that sort of faded colour. But clearly, there's a downside to that. It requires a lot of energy, and you actually mechanically sort of bring down the jeans as well as the colour partially. And so now you use cellulases, which are, again, enzymes like amylases or proteases that sort of biologically and genetically create the same effect, lower temperature with less energy using cellulases. So now we're going to look at this, we're going to move on to this idea of how do you create these biocatalysts, what are the principles that you can use in the laboratory to engineer enzymes that are more suitable for industrial applications. And what you need to do here is look at how nature improves things. Okay, so you'll be familiar with this, so natural selection. And the issue is, can you learn from nature, which is what we do a lot in our lab, can you learn from nature, and can you basically take those technologies and somehow import them into your lab and use them in a sort of practical manner? So this is where you'll know this story. Darwin was the first person really to propose this whole idea of natural selection in the late 19th century, and wrote this famous book, The Origin of the Species, basically by going around the world and observing differences, natural differences in populations of animals, birds, etc., and sort of thinking about, you know, how, what was the most likely sort of way in which those differences could have emerged. So he famously went to the Galapagos Islands, which are a series of islands off the west coast of South America, where you have seemingly related birds, these finches, but they're all slightly different. And they all seem, when you look at them, they all seem to have adapted to this particular food or whatever was available on that individual island. And then it was well known, this idea of breeding was well developed even in the 19th century. So although people didn't really understand the underlying mechanism for how you cross plants and get offspring of different colour or bigger or more fruit, dogs have been bred for a long time. They all essentially descend from a single species of breeds of dog. If you look at the whole point of this, if you look at those dogs, you wouldn't believe, or it's not obvious that they all descend from a single genetic species. So breeding gets you there. And the question is really, what's the sort of underlying process? So Darwin came up with this sort of almost the biggest idea in science, this idea of natural selection. And it really relates to a sort of a number of facts. One is that organisms produce way more offspring than can survive. If you do the maths, you know, if you think about rabbits, classic example, how often they breed and how many offspring they produce. If they all survived, within a few years the planet would be covered in rabbits. So more offspring than can survive. Individuals vary in their characteristics, so there's that natural variation. And importantly, and this was the big thing, it was not sort of universally agreed in the mid-19th century, characteristics are inherited from parents by through their genes. So it follows logically that some individuals will be better suited to their environment. They inherit the genes of their parents, they survive, they reproduce, and that gives them some sort of advantage in respect of the environment in which they're placed. So they help their sort of relatives. So as a result, organisms evolve over time. Now this, so what you have here now is a sort of potentially a mechanism for changing things, for evolving things. The problem with this is it takes a long, long time. And the reason it takes a long time is even rabbits can breed in a few weeks or a few months. So if you're going to take this process and put it into the laboratory, you've got to speed this movie up, because you can't afford to wait years, tens of years for things to happen. You need to take this basic principle and get it to work much more quickly. So that's what we're going to look at. How can enzymes be improved in the laboratory so that they're suitable for industrial biotechnology? How can we use this basic mechanism? So this is what we do, and this is what people call laboratory evolution of enzymes. Basically, you just use the same sort of principle. You take a gene, which is a piece of DNA that encodes the enzyme, you make I'll talk a little bit about this, you make a library of mutated genes, so you randomly mutate the DNA sequence. It's quite easy to do that. For instance, using error-prone PCR, polymerase chain reaction. You then take that library of genes and convert it into a library of enzymes. So now you've got a population of different enzymes. And then you screen those enzymes for some sort of activity, higher stability, higher catalytic activity. You find something that's improved, and then you go back and you repeat the process again. So it's basically copying evolution, doing it in a much faster way, in a much more targeted way in the laboratory. And you can do this in a matter of weeks, okay? Because the reason is you do this in typically E. coli, and E. coli divide every few minutes. Okay, so you've truncated that whole process by picking a system that is rapidly evolving, rapidly dividing, and then you can get it into the timescales of the sort of chemistry experiment. Now, just a comment on the numbers. What sort of numbers are we talking about? Right, for an if you've got an enzyme, a typical enzyme would say have 400 amino acids. There are 20 to the 400 total possible variations on that sequence. Because there are 20 amino acids and you've got 400 positions. Right, this is primed a couple. Does anybody know how many atoms there are in the universe? And if you do know, I mean, I just want to give you a sense of how big 20 to 400 is. How many guess the number of atoms in the universe? I asked this once and somebody got it spot on. They didn't know that time, they didn't know the answer.
10 to the 80.
10 to the 80, very good. Right, so 20 to the 400 is just astronomical. Now, if you go about it, let's go from a bottom-up approach. Let's take that protein and change one amino acid in 400 for any of the other possible 19. You generate 8,000 different sequences. And that's made an insignificant change to the protein, and you've generated already quite a lot of different enzymes. And then you can see the numbers too. By four, if you change 1% of the amino acids in the protein, you generate 64 million different variants. Now, in our lab, it's possible to screen maybe 10 to the 8. That would be the absolute upper limit. Probably more like 10 to the 6, 10 to the 7. So the issue here is you can create anything, but you can't actually screen more than about a million. Okay, so that's something we think about a lot. We devise ways in our lab of coping with those numbers. But proteins is what people, protein sequence space is vast. So here's a real project. So we're going to move more onto the applications now. This is an enzyme called monoamine oxidase N, and it oxidizes amines to imines. I don't want to get too much into the detail, but basically we have evolved this enzyme. We took the wild-type enzyme on the left-hand side, which works on very simple substrates such as butylamine. We used that process of laboratory evolution, creating libraries, screening enzymes, finding the best hits, going back and doing more optimization. We used it to evolve like a sort of group of enzymes with much broader activity, much higher specificity for applications that you'll see on the next slide. And if you're interested in terms of, you know, what sort of quantitative improvements do you get, you know, 1,000-fold improvement in activity. So you're not getting small insignificant changes, you're getting 10 to the 3, 3 orders of magnitude improvement in activity. So the reason we did this is we're now going to start to look at some applications. We were interested in this compound. This is a drug called tenapremir, and it's one of a new class of pharmaceuticals for treating hepatitis C. So there were about 2 or 3 years ago, a series of drugs started to be launched, which are essentially revolutionary ways of curing people with hepatitis C. They actually remove the virus from your blood system. Tenapremir was one of the first things launched. And what we did is we used our evolved enzymes to take that simple starting material on the left-hand side and convert it to a chiral intermediate, that so-called imine, and we used that as a synthetic building block for making hepatitis C drug tenapremir. Now, the issue here is, in fact, we patented this process. We licensed this chemistry to a pharmaceutical company. We're now using it to make the drug, so that's nice. And the issue here is that, as you probably can imagine, most of the people in the world who've got hepatitis C live in the third world. They can't afford to buy relatively expensive drugs like this. So this drug currently costs around $40,000 for an 8-week treatment, which is completely outside the sort of remit of people who live in, you know, Africa, India, South America. So the idea here is to develop a much cheaper, this is a cheaper route, to make this drug available to people in third world countries. So some other examples, some from our work, some from other companies. And I thought I'd give you sort of, you know, household products. As you're probably not aware, but if you use shampoos, hair creams, there's a compound called isopropyl myristate, which is simply the isopropyl ester of myristic acid. And as you see, it's made by a company in Wigan called Croda. Now, what they do, so now we're going to start to look at some really sustainable processes. They take myristic acid, which is that stuff in the top left-hand corner, which is present in very high concentrations in nutmeg. So now you have a sustainable source, potentially, of the starting material. Plant you can grow, it sustainably to produce myristic acid. And there's a lot of myristic acid in nutmeg. And then the issue now is how do you convert it to the product, which is the isopropyl ester. As I say, it's a so-called emollient. It goes into shampoos, hand creams. It makes your skin feel soft. It gets absorbed into your skin. So it's a cosmetic ingredient. If you look on the back of a typical cosmetic, shampoo and hair cream, there are about 50 chemicals. It's quite scary how many different things are in there. All of those are essentially made from oil-derived raw materials. So cosmetics, you've definitely got to think of sustainable ways of making those. So this is the process that Croda developed. They take myristic acid, isopropanol, and they use an enzyme called Novozyme, which is a commercial biocatalyst, and simply do a esterification to make the isopropyl ester. Now, you know, you may have studied esterification of carboxylic acids. If you do it in the lab, typically you use concentrated sulfuric acid. So you might ask the question, why would you want to use a biocatalyst for such a simple chemical reaction? The clue is at the bottom. If you use biocatalyst to make isopropyl myristate, you can claim that it's a natural process. Okay, if you use sulfuric acid, that's not a natural process. An enzyme is a natural catalyst. If you say it's made naturally, you can charge more for the product. And that is sound, this is not very scientific, because essentially the product is the same, but the process by which you made it is different. This is very, if you pick up rockets, for instance, they'll often say natural vanilla or natural reproduced ingredients. You can typically charge about 10 times more. For it to be natural, then you need a natural starting material and a natural catalyst, such as biocatalyst, to do the transformation. Right, another molecule which you meet every day of your life, you probably don't know, is called a racemide, which is that amide on the right hand side. It goes into all sorts of products, particularly plastic bags, until it's impregnated into polyethylene. It makes plastic bags very easy to open, otherwise the polyethylene tends to stick to each other. So it's a huge volume product. And again, you can make it from a renewable starting material called erucic acid, which is present in rapeseed oil. It's a huge amount of rapeseed grown all around the world. Some of it's used for cooking for oil, but you can also extract erucic acid from rapeseed oil. Now, the current manufacturing process for erucic acid, is this classic chemistry. You take erucic acid, you heat it up with ammonia, 180 degrees, 125 psi. Okay, so that's a pretty, that's a sledgehammer to crack a nut, so the chemical reaction is not very subtle. High temperature, high pressure. So very energy intensive. If the temperature goes above 200, you get dehydration of amide to give the nitrile. That's a common problem in high temperature chemistry, you get side reactions. If you generate the nitrile, then you've got to purify the nitrile away from the amide, so you have downstream purification problems. That increases the cost of the process. So, probably guess what's coming. If you use a biocatalyst, biocatalysts, like all catalysts, lower the conditions required for the reaction, so you can now run this reaction at 90 degrees C, so 90 biocatalysts work at ambient pressure to pressurize them. You can, so it's a catalytic process, you can use, rather use ammonia, you can use urea, ammonium carbonate, which is easier to handle, easier to transport, more environmentally friendly, and you get a high conversion process. So it sort of becomes self-evident why companies are looking at their chemical processes, and that's what they're doing. It's seeing, can I replace the chemical process with a biotechnology-based process? So a few more examples just to sort of finish. This is a very interesting product made by DuPont called Serona, which is a polymer which goes into all sorts of fabrics. The polymer industry is huge, but it's one of the largest components of the chemical industry. Again, all of the raw materials are made from oil, including terephthalic acid, which is here. So at the moment there's no replacement, there's no bio replacement for terephthalic acid. The propane diol is now made biologically by fermentation. And so what they did is they developed a new polymer where they co-polymerized propane diol, which is biologically derived, with terephthalic acid to give this terephthalate-based polymer. And the propane diol is made by fermentation, but the feedstock is corn. Okay, now again, corn is grown, it's not grown so much in this country. In the US, corn is grown on a vast scale. Some of it you can eat. And the nice thing with corn is the kernel you can't eat, but you can ferment. Okay, so it's very similar to the bioethanol situation in Brazil, where they use sugarcane to make bioethanol. A third of it they eat, a third of it they burn, and a third of it they ferment to make bioethanol. So that's actually starting to look a bit more reasonable. You can get total usage of the crop by eating a bit of it, so that it can turn into chemicals or energy. This is a very nice example. Goodyear have switched over to making tyres from bioisomer. So isoprene, which is naturally derived from latex, from the rubber tree, is used as a, it's basically a precursor to rubber. Okay, again, there's concerns about rubber trees. They can only grow them in certain parts of the world. They're not particularly sustainable. So Genicor developed a fermentation method of producing isoprene using an engineered microorganism. And one of the keys to this process is if you look up the boiling point of isoprene, it's around about 50 degrees C. So what, if you think about a fermentation, it's quite a complex thing. There's some nutrients, there are other things in there. If you can distill out your product, which is what they do here, you have a very easy way of purifying the product, and that keeps the cost down. You don't have to do complicated sort of downstream processing. So the key to this really is this relatively low boiling point. If you ever get the opportunity to go to lectures by motor car automotive manufacturers, it's incredible how much of a car now is made from renewable material. Something like 40% of cars are made, some cars are made from renewable material. So, so the engine obviously is going to be made from metal. But if you think about all of the inside of the car, that can all be made from feedstocks. So the big motor car manufacturers are hugely into this, not just tyres, but hugely into this idea of making more and more of their cars from renewable materials because of the sheer volume that they produce cars on. And this is the last one. Well, that's from trash to gas. So there's a company actually in the north of England called Ineos. This is probably, I thought I'd finish on this slide, this is sort of the way it is going to be done. Because we produce so much municipal waste, the obvious thing to do is convert waste to fuel. Because what else you can do with it? Well, put it in landfills. So they have developed a process, again, a biotechnology-based process, where they take municipal waste, feed it into their system, and convert it into bioethanol. Now one thing we haven't really sort of touched on is that one of the issues around fuel is transportation costs. So you can make fuel, but then you've got to transport it. And if the transportation cost is very, very high, then you've sort of haven't really solved the problem because you've added a lot of cost just to actually moving the material around. The model here is that throughout the world you could have these local sort of biorefineries making biofuel on a local scale. It could even be farmers. So people have sort of rehearsed this model. Could farms, if they don't become, if they're not productive producing food, could they be used as local biorefineries for sort of biofuel production? So rather than have only a few biorefineries all around the world, you have lots of little biorefineries all using municipal waste or stuff that we can't eat, and they're producing it for this. So there's a Northwest biorefinery which would service Manchester, for instance. Right, last slide. And one more point to make. So what I've tried to convince you is industrial biotechnology, it will be increasingly, it is being increasingly used to make chemicals, pharmaceuticals, fuels, and chemicals for the future, the reasons we went into. There is no industry uses this because the processes are generally cheaper, they're definitely more sustainable, they have less environmental impact, so that includes safety, potentially safer processes, that's important. The last point is the one to take home, is that if most of what I've talked about today is you have a chemical product which you already produce a biochemical process, and then you try and replace that chemical process by a biotech process. Okay. The future, which is you guys get involved, which is the research, is that you develop a new generation of products based on what is available. So you don't just make replacement products. You say, what do we have? So we have sugars, develop a completely new set of products. And you're starting to see this with polymers. You develop a new set of products that are based on what you have, not what we used to make, and now we're trying to make it in a more sort of eco-efficient way. So that's when the tipping point will happen. That's the sort of hockey stick reflection point when you switch over truly to a sort of bio-based world based on availability of materials. And on that note, I think I'm done now. So thank you. So there's this phrase in our world, you get what you screen for. You do. You get exactly what you screen for, because depending upon what you're looking for, that's what you pick out. Yes?
How long will it take to develop an enzyme to get what is?
Story we tell, I've done this quite a few times here, is, again, sort of following on from the previous question, if you want to work with an enzyme, there are certain things you need to be able to do. You need to be able to screen. That takes a little bit of time to develop a new way of screening for the activity. You need to be able to express your enzyme in typically E. coli. That can sometimes take a little while. You need to find the right starting point. So that's the key to the decision. Once you've got all of those bits in place, the express enzyme, the screen, the method for making libraries. Making libraries is actually relatively straightforward. There's a lot of ways of doing that. Once you've got it all in place, then you're talking about a matter of weeks. It can take months to get everything into place. And once you've got the system set up, you can build a new enzyme in a matter of weeks. But that's where the chemical industry is picking up on this. If it took years, it would just not work for them. In fact, you could find what they want in a few weeks, that's extremely attractive, so they can then compare it to their chemical approach.
Yes. What do you think it's going to take to shift from sort of a crude oil based set of products to this biological set of products? Is it going to be running out of the oil? Is it going to be more economic or political demands that's going to
transition? I think that's the big question. If you look at a lot of bio based products, quite a lot of them are heavily subsidized. So governments can encourage people to use biofuels by just making them cheaper. If you go into a gas station and buy sort of petrol, it's probably about 5% biofuel. It's already ethanol is already blended into fuels. But the UK is sort of somewhere in between. I think in Hungary it's about 10% because they have government subsidies encouraging the use of biofuels. So you've got, you know, this can make a massive difference if the company gets a huge subsidy. So you've got the sort of political angle, you've got the almost daily changing forecast of whether oil is running out or not. See, oil companies, they talk about making biofuels, but they don't really need to make biofuels, because they're basically, oil companies are engineering companies. we've had collaborations with oil companies. They don't really have a very strong sense of research. Research takes a long time, it's expensive, and sometimes it doesn't work. If you're an oil company, you go to the North Sea, you build a platform, you dig oil out of the ground, and they understand how to do that. That's their job. So there's that. There's the whole, who's going to do this, and the oil companies really just want to dig oil out of the ground. And then the third thing is, again, to people like you, the chemical industry is full of chemists. You, the opportunities for people to study chemistry and learn how to do this are enormous. At the moment, there are not enough people working in the chemical industry who know how to do this. And that takes a long time, it almost takes a generation to train the next cohort of scientists. And they're going to be chemists. A lot of these companies, what they want people with good chemical skills, because chemists understand kinetics, thermodynamics, mechanisms, stereochemistry. But you're going to have to use a different set of tools to make the chemical, so you need to understand the biology as well. And that takes quite a long time to essentially, you know, replace a whole workforce of classic organic chemists with people who know how to do cloning, expression, and biology. What we do in our group is we take chemists, we re-engineer them. Re-engineer proteins, we re-engineer people as well. We take chemists and we train them how to do this, and they pick it up very, very quickly because they've got a very good chemical sense. And for them, this is another chemical reaction. It's another way of doing chemistry. So.
Thank you.
Yes.